The sun is just coming up on another wonderful day in the world of serviced accommodation. Wherever you are, don't miss out. This year is going to be the best year for staycations, for holidays. It is truly a breathtaking dawn for those that venture into the world of serviced accommodation.
Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Money Matters, because after all, money does matter. Now, what magical money secret are we going to explore today? Today, I want to take a bit of an in-depth look at the world of serviced accommodation. Why? Because it changed my world, and I'm guessing if you do what you need to do, it could change yours as well. Who is Paul Smith? Well, that'll be me. Paul Smith, Touch and Education. There's a lot of Paul Smiths about. I just want to be clear about which one I am, because even in my primary school class, there were three of us. So I was called the Paul Smith, and the other two were called by their second names. Some sort of, I don't know, it was just a sort of weird thing. Three of us all called the same thing in the same class at the same time. Anyway, over the years, I've become wealthy through property. And I'm sat here in my villa in the south of France recording this because I want you to become wealthy through property too. And I've got in front of me a little slideshow. So you'll see me recording it and you'll see the slideshow that I want to take you through as well. Okay, so let's get going. Wealth through property. Well, I'm a working class kid brought up in a Yorkshire mining town. Why do you sound like a southerner, Paul? Well, I did all my primary schooling in Yorkshire and then I did all my secondary schooling in Hertfordshire. So I've probably got a Hertfordshire accent, just to clear up that little mystery. But anyway, here is the time when I first got interested in property. Look at that. That's me messing about with a digger at the age of three. I don't remember it, but there's photographic evidence. That is definitely me, and that is definitely a digger. What I used to do is, that was just over the road from where mum and, well, where the family lived. Just me and mum and dad, because I'm the oldest at the time. And it's that golden age when you can run about and actually be a kid, be a child. So I was pretty much out and about every day with my mates. You know, even before I went to school, we just run around the streets together. And we used to go and play on the building site. Can you imagine that today? Health and safety, not allowed. Get off, don't touch. So I was literally brought up on a building site. What's that got to do with wealth through property? Well, I guess from my earliest days, I've been fascinated by property. My granddad built his own house. That's my English granddad. My Irish granddad was an auctioneer, so he bought and sold all kinds of businesses and properties and hotels. So I was just kind of surrounded by it from a really small boy, really small child. And I'm going to keep coming back to this. That is just behind me, that tree over there. So I just hung my shirt, it's my football shirt from the football team that I support, on the tree, took a picture of it. What did you do that for? I'm going to keep coming back to it and see if you think that seven is a lucky number by the end of it, because that's my lucky number. In the olden days, seven didn't really mean seven. Seven just meant a lot, because before people were generally educated, most people couldn't count to seven. So seven just meant loads. And that's why I chose seven to be my lucky number. Of course, it means loads. But why seven specifically, and why today, and why now? Well, we'll get there, I promise. I want to talk to you, like I said, about serviced accommodation. Now, here's our first one, way back in 2014. That's a picture of the bedroom, obviously. And I just want to explain, I had been talking, networking, to a property investor about the idea of serviced accommodation. And I just immediately wanted to grab that opportunity. Now, as luck would have it, a few weeks after that initial opportunity, one of our buy-to-let tenants moved out. So back in 2014, we had commercial property, we had property in our pension, so we had a number of different kinds of property. But if I just focus on our buy-to-lets, our buy-to-let portfolio was bringing us £3,500 a month, which is fine, but it's not exactly the stuff that allows you to go and buy villas in the south of France. It's a nice secondary income, but I would not describe it as wealth. One of our buy-to-lets comes empty. It's just a little one-bedroom flat in a place called Dumbarton. We were living in Scotland at the time. So it would be 15 minutes, or it is 15 minutes from Glasgow Airport, something like that. What was it worth at the time? 50,000, 60,000? So it's just a little small flat in an ordinary street or station road in Dumbarton, just opposite Dumbarton Central train station. I just had this mad idea. Aniko, my wife, wasn't exactly convinced at the time, so she put me on quite a tight budget, because this is unfurnished. So she paid for a skip and gave me 300 quid. I was like, well, Jesus, how much? She said, you'll find a way. And I deeply believe that. See, the deal that we've got with myself and Aniko, my wife, is unless we both want to do something, we won't do it. And that way, neither of us can say after the fact, I told you so. So Aniko wasn't convinced it would work. She's an accountant. She's trained to look at the why nots. So the reason the furniture looks so funny and nothing matches anything, I physically emptied all the old clutter out from the old tenant and threw it in a skip. And that street, by the way, is the sort of street where if you don't fill a skip pretty quick, someone else will do it for you. So I was working quite hard to get it filled quick. With just all the rubbish they'd left behind. And some of the furniture that I put into that apartment was just sort of spare clutter from our house. But I needed beds, I needed that wardrobe and all that sort of stuff. Now, just over the road, or just under the railway, there's a second-hand shop, as luck would have it. Second-hand furniture shop, you know, one of these sort of charity, it was actually a warehouse rather than a shop. So I went in there, and it was a hot day, so I was sort of sweating and everything. I walked in, and the woman said to me, you're right. She said, you look a bit warm. I said, well, I am, as it happens. I said, well, the thing is, I need some furniture. I've only got 300 quid. She said, oh, you poor thing. Sit down. I'll get you a cup of tea. I don't know what she thought. I was homeless, unemployed, or what. I don't know. Literally, 300 quid and a skip is how I started my service accommodation journey. Here's the next lucky. There's that football shirt again. When I came to talking to the lady in the charity warehouse about sofas, she didn't have a sofa. She said, I've only got a sofa bed. Will that do? I said, how much is it? And she said, 15 quid. I said, that's fine. Well, it's lucky because completely by accident, I put a sofa bed into my first ever service accommodation unit. That gives me the ability, even in a one bedroom flat, to sleep up to four people suddenly. Now, okay, realistically on that little sofa bed, it'd have to be a couple of kids or something. But even if it's a full-sized adult, you can sleep three instead of two. And I'm sure you'd agree this service accommodation is pretty basic. I mean, it was clean enough. A little tiny bathroom, a little tiny sort of galley kitchen, a lounge and a bedroom. And that was about it. So you could sleep three, possibly, if they're very small people, four people using that sofa bed. Who stayed there? Well, tradesmen. Now, let's go back to the bedroom and have a look. That's why I've got the two single beds in there. Because typically, I'd have, you know, gigantic, hairy, tattooed plumbers or whatever it is. They'll share a room, but they don't particularly want to share a bed. In fact, I wouldn't want to be suggesting it to them. And there it is. So that's the booking.com listing from 2014 or whenever it was. All three of them are mine. So we actually had 10 in that street, which we converted to service accommodation. So 10 in one street, making decent money. Wow, Paul, wasn't that saturating the market? Well, actually, no, it wasn't. But, you know, times change. And because I started teaching about service accommodation and people found out I had my apartments in Dumbarton, there are only two places in the UK that you can't do new listings on Airbnb. One is Edinburgh, because it's the most popular service accommodation, furnished holiday let type destination in the UK. And the second is Dumbarton, because of all the people that I've taught over the years, they've all set up in Dumbarton. So actually, I've actually wound down my operations in Dumbarton and gone somewhere else because Dumbarton's only got about, 20,000 people in it. You can't have 500 service departments. And there were hundreds of service departments because everyone thought, oh, Paul's in Dumbarton. I'm like, please leave me alone. Got the rest of the UK to go and focus on. But anyway, different story for a different day. So for me, it was a total game changer. So let me just share the figures with you for the first 6 months. Aniko came on board and we started converting many more of our properties and buying, so converting them from buy-to-lets into service accommodation units and buying more. Back then, it's a lot more now, but way back then, the single let private rent on that one bedroom flat in Dumbarton was £325 a month. And then after I take off my mortgage, my letting fees, my voids, maintenance and all, insurance and all that stuff, that left me with a cash flow of about £125 a month, which, wasn't that exciting. So we had quite a few buy-to-lets making up that £3,500. And these were the lowest, by the way. So, we had others at £200-£300, but nothing more than that, really, per month, I mean, profit. And in 2014, because of service accommodation, everything changed. And suddenly we were getting service accommodation per night from that same flat that we would get £325 a month from. So that, roughly, round numbers, that's £10 a night, isn't it? And suddenly it went boom to £54 to £99 a night. Why so different, Paul? Well, £54 was for one person. I think it was 70 something if it was two people, or if it's three people or three or four people, it was £99. So please make sure you charge more per person per night. And we achieve an average occupancy of 75%, which is pretty typical for most parts of the UK, I later discovered. Obviously didn't know that then, I know it now. Here's how the numbers turned out. Lucky number seven, again. Lucky Smith, lucky number seven. We actually grossed £6,268 in the first 6 months in that little tiny one-bedroom flat in Dumbarton. And that gave us, after we'd taken off the money to pay, you know, the housekeepers, do the linen, pay the utilities and mortgage and everything else, that left us with £3,447 net, which if you divide that by six is roughly £575 per month on average, which is five times more than the same property had been given us as a single let. And that's when we thought, boom, we're in. So our buy-to-lets had previously, if you added them all together, given us £3,500 a month. And we didn't even convert all of them because we didn't want to go and kick out families and stuff. So it's just as they were coming empty, we started converting them to serviced accommodation. And as serviced accommodation, suddenly those exact same properties, well, as I say, not even all of them, suddenly started giving us £15,000 a month. Now, that, my friends, for me, or for us anyway, was a game changer. That's £180,000 a year. And that is the basis for why I'm sat here in the south of France talking to you about serviced accommodation. In 2015, I wrote my number one best-selling serviced accommodation success manual. Tens of thousands of people have bought it, which has been fantastic. So that's, you know, another income stream, because I think it sells for $18.99 or some funny number like that. By the time I've paid Amazon and, and printed it and whatever, I make about 15 quid profit off of every one of those. And I sell quite a few a day, even still, you know, in 2021, years and years later. When can I go on holiday abroad or in the UK? And up came this BBC news article. If you can see, it's quite small down at the bottom. It says, anyone in England who travels abroad without good reason will soon face a fine of £5,000. They're pretty serious about this. What does that mean in practice? Does that mean, therefore, that many, many fewer people than normal are going to go on holiday abroad this year from the UK? Yes, of course they are. So where are they going to go on holiday? Well, they're going to go on holiday in the UK. Staycations, holistays. I'm sure you've heard of all these phrases and you're probably considering it yourself. Is that your opportunity? Because, you know, consider where we are now, either convert a buy-to-let or even buy a house under the stamp duty holiday or get a rent-to-rent. You could have serviced accommodation up and running for this July, August. Easy, absolutely easy. I set my first one up in 2 days. I mean, you need to learn how. You can't go breaking the law. You can't breach your mortgage conditions. You can't breach your lease conditions. You've got to register for data protection. There's stuff you've got to do, but I know what you need to do, so I can teach you if you're interested. And that same BBC article goes on to say, when can I go on holiday abroad? Returning to travellers have to quarantine. Foreign holidays are not allowed. There's going to be a report apparently on the 12th of April detailing how and when international travel can resume. But one of the government's top scientific advisors said it's very unlikely people will be able to go abroad on holiday because of the risk that travellers might bring coronavirus variants back to the UK. And the Defence Secretary, Ben Wallace, told the BBC that an extension to the ban on foreign holidays could not be ruled out. Really? Okay. Thank you for that deep insight, Ben Wallace. I'm not shocked. New research has found that 83% of British travellers would prefer a UK staycation to travelling abroad this year. Well, with all the risks and quarantine and having to have expensive COVID tests that you have to pay, you know, all that stuff. Some people are going to make huge profits this summer. So the question isn't, are people going to make huge profits that offer serviced accommodation this summer? The question is, do you want to be one of them? Because you can be. You need to get yourself in a gear, move, but you can be. So what kind of SA properties do you do now, Paul? That is a fantastic question. And there's where luck comes in again. Or is it luck? Because I'm now presenting you with the same opportunity that I had 7 years ago. This is the first time you've ever heard about serviced accommodation. Are you going to grab it with both hands like I did? This is the kind of property that we now do as serviced accommodation. So we've still got little flats and houses and things that are fantastic for contractors. But if you want to focus on holistays, then I suggest you get yourself 3-4 bedroom houses, or maybe even bigger, with nice gardens, where people actually want to go on holiday. So we lived in this house from 2004 to 2019. So it was our family home for 15 years, and it's on the west coast of Scotland. It looks out over the sea, it stands in more than an acre of grounds, it's got 8 bedrooms, it's gorgeous, it's £1 million house. So when we moved to Doncaster in 2019, we decided to keep it as a serviced accommodation unit. So how did it do last year with lockdown and COVID and all those things? It's going to go bust, really? Well, August, we were fully occupied, 500 quid a night, which brought in £16,500 in 1 month. Now, the mortgage on it is 1,300 quid. Now, you need to learn about all the stuff, you know, like what you've got to pay for, housekeeping, linen, how do you let guests in and out, should you do a welcome pack, and that sort of property, yes, you should. If I take account of all the deductions that you need to make, and all the registrations and the permits and everything else that you need, it's not hard, you just need to know what you need. We made a profit on that one property of way more than £12,000 in 1 month. Now, was that the best month last year? Yeah, it's August in Scotland. That's when people go on holiday. Did we do all right the rest of the year? Yes, we did. We absolutely did. So how does 2021 look? Even though there's this total uncertainty about when can we get out and when is the lockdown going to be over? Well, look at that. Syke Country Cottages got us a booking from the 7th of August to the 21st of August. That's 2 weeks. This summer coming up for £11,900 for 2 weeks. Because of what happened last year, we've massively increased our prices. I think it's only 1 week left in August now, and it's something like £8,500 for 1 week. This one property will easily make us more than £100,000 profit, clear and clean, this year. And because we know what we're doing, we're not going to pay any tax on that, which is another beauteous thing about the world of serviced accommodation. So do you want to know more? I'm guessing you do, because you're still watching. That is my house in Yorkshire. That's £1 million house. That is my house in Scotland. That's £1 million house. That is where I'm talking to you from now. That's our villa on the Riviera, obviously in the south of France. Behind me over there, just over that hill, is Cannes. That is a £2 million villa that we're in the process of turning into a £3 million villa. All of this is possible because of serviced accommodation. But Paul, how are you affording all that? Does that look like somewhere that you might want to come on holiday? So you could use that as serviced accommodation, Paul. Yes, you could. That is my most recent company vehicle. It's currently being refurbished and it will soon snugly be parked down in that little harbour that you can see there. So I would imagine that will be tucked in there for me and the family and all of our wonderful Touchstone staff team. They'll be coming over and we'll be having that's a bit of employee incentive, if you like. So I hope they enjoy it. That is our most recent car. Aniko bought that in January. Years and years ago, I bought myself a Maserati t-shirt and I told my mum, we were in Italy at the time, I said to my mum, I'm going to buy a Maserati to go with that one day. And we did that this January. This working class kid from a Yorkshire mining town has now got a Swiss bank wealth account. Go check out Julius Bear. Now, to even open the kind of account we've got, you have to deposit £1.5 million. Go check it out. Go and check it out. 7 years on. Was I lucky or was it hard work? Oh, that's what you keep putting that football shirt in the picture for, Paul. Yes, it's 7 years, almost to the day, since we started serviced accommodation. We started in 2014. It's now 2021. So we've been doing this for 7 years. Lucky number seven. Well, was that luck? Or did we just grab the opportunity with both hands and do some hard work? This is the sort of problem that myself and Aniko now sit at this table and consider. If you look over that hill and then over the next hill, you can actually see Monaco. Now, because of wealth through property, because of the various income streams that we've got flowing from different property types, because of serviced accommodation, because that really was the game changer for us in 2014, we are now actively considering taking up Monaco residency. The amount of money it will cost us if we don't do that will just be astronomical. Even with our knowledge of business, Aniko's an accountant, our years, decades of experience, even using all our capital allowances, there is no way that over the next 12 months we will be able to reduce our income tax bill to zero. So we're looking at the next logical step. We've already spent several months of lockdown here. I'd far rather be locked down here than back in the UK. We're about to go back to the UK. We're back in the UK for a couple of months. And then July and August, all of July, all of August, we'll be back down here again. We've got a decision to make. And we're talking to the children about, would they value the opportunity to learn French and to finish their schooling? It makes sense, because Jenny will be doing her O-levels next year, and Jude will just be coming up to his choices. So if they are going to move, it makes sense to move in about a year's time. It's a first world problem, isn't it? Should I move to Monaco for tax purposes because of serviced accommodation, or should I stay where I am? So I don't know. I mean, 7 years from now, would you like that kind of problem? Shall I move to Monaco or not? And I was actually, before I recorded this, I was just looking at property prices in Monaco. I think what I'll probably do is rent one first, get to know the area a little bit, and then purchase one a year or so later. And I was actually surprised at how relatively cheap the rents are. You can get a really nice apartment in Monaco for 9,000-10,000 euros a month, which is a no-brainer, because in the season, this property here rents out, and net to owner after all costs is 9,000 euros a week. So I could rent this property out for the 12 weeks of the season, and that would pay my year's rent in Monaco. That's just nuts, absolutely nuts. And the property prices in Monaco are actually less than my tax bill will be next year. So I've got a choice. I don't know what you would do. Would you give millions of pounds to the UK government so they could invest it wisely? Because I don't want to fall out with any politicians, but I don't particularly think they're very sensible when it comes to spending any tax money that we might give them. And I know for some people it's going to be moral outrage. That's ridiculous. Who's leaving the UK? Well, put yourself in my shoes. What would you do? I want to build wealth through property for future generations, and I don't want to give half of it to the UK government. We pay millions and millions in tax, just not income tax. We've got 35 wonderful staff members, so PAYE. Number two, we pay many thousands in national insurance on behalf of those staff, employers' national insurance, as well as the employees' national insurance. Well, that's source of government revenue number two. The people that earn that money then go off and spend it, and the government collects VAT on that. That's government source of revenue number three by size. We buy a lot of property. We're currently buying roughly one property a week. Property taxes, stamp duty, that sort of stuff. Well, that's government source of revenue number four. So we as individuals are already contributing millions of pounds to UK PLC. So it isn't a question of, am I going to avoid paying taxes? No. I am causing millions of pounds worth of taxes to be paid. The question is, do I want to take advantage of the tax breaks internationally and relocate to Monaco or Switzerland or, you know, wherever it takes? Below this video in the text box, you'll see a link. Click on that link and it'll give you access to a mini series that I put together with loads of detail, loads of case studies about how we've helped thousands and thousands of people to become wealthy through property. And this whole mini-series in that link down there is about serviced accommodation. So if you like the idea, one day, of contending with first world problems, like shall I move to Monaco or not, then you're potentially one click away from a different life. Do something today that your future self will thank you for. Click on that link and become wealthy, and then take your choices. You've been wonderful. I've been Paul. See you next time. Bye-bye for now.